My stepfather was an alcoholic, and he had times where he was very abusive to my mother and to us. It was like Jekyll and Hyde. When he was sober, he was the nicest guy.
Frank's mom was an artist and a New Age psychic.
Somewhere along the line, she converted from going to church to attending these meditation groups. And they'd meet in the living room of our home, and I would sit on the stairs. I would listen in, and they would do things like channel spirits, create angels. And for many years, she was just consumed by this stuff.
Frank longed to escape the abuse and his confusing home life. He began smoking pot and dropping acid at the age of 11.
I was doing what all the other kids were doing. You were either a head or you were a jock. So I was a head.
When Frank was 12, his mom discovered his drug addiction and sent him away to live with his father.
Frank!
I came out here to live with my dad, who I didn't know at all, and brought my suitcase of clothes and my suitcase of drugs and problems too. And my poor dad didn't have a clue on how to deal with any of it. He tried just everything he could think of. And, I was pretty gone at that point.
Frank started using heroin and other narcotics. At 16, he left home and dropped out of school. He and a friend came up with a plan to get as many drugs as they wanted.
I became what's known as a drugstore cowboy. I burglarized many drugstores, and that was my lifestyle. I had all these narcotics, and I was taking them, and I was selling them, and I got away with it for years.
And then he got caught.
That was the first time I had gotten arrested, too, and they locked me up for 10 years. I did 3 years on the 10.
After his release, Frank overdosed on heroin and was declared dead on arrival at the hospital. Even though doctors resuscitated him, he remained in a coma for 4 days.
I don't remember actually hitting the floor. I just remember my arm being on the table and the needle pushing the plunger going down. And then the next thing I know, I was on this hill. I'm on my hands and knees facing up. And it was so real that I could smell the grass. And there's a guy standing there in a white robe. All I could see was the feet, the sandals, the holes in the feet. And I reached up and I grabbed the robe with both my hands and was just clutching it with all I was worth. And I said, I was begging him, please don't take me now. Please don't take me now.
Frank made a miraculous recovery, but he went right back to drugs.
I just thought I was doomed to be locked up for the rest of my life and to be an addict. I just felt morally broke, bankrupt. I couldn't do it anymore.
Frank was in treatment at a halfway house when a friend from the past, who had become a Christian, showed up.
It was a guy I'd bought heroin from, and he invited me and another group of guys to go pray. Well, he started praying, and he'd say a couple of words, and then we'd follow along, repeating the salvation prayer. We were standing in a circle holding hands. There wasn't a guy in the room who didn't have tears rolling down their cheeks, including myself. We stayed down there for quite a while, just praising and worshiping the Lord and thanking him, and I didn't really understand what I was even doing, to be honest with you. But I just was following along, and I knew it felt good, and I felt really different. I felt like a big load was off my back. I wasn't depressed anymore. I felt confident all of a sudden. Felt like there was hope.
Afterwards, Frank had some questions.
I said, what just happened down there, man? I experienced something, and he laughed, and he said, well, you just got saved, and the Holy Spirit just entered your heart. And I was like, what? I didn't really understand even what that meant.
Frank had stashed some drugs to get him by while going through treatment. No one knew about them.
That night before I went to bed, a voice foreign to my own in my mind said, throw away the pills.
Frank decided to throw the pills in a dumpster on his way to treatment.
Everyone had already gone in, and so I was like a minute or a minute and a half late. And my counselor was standing at the door, and he was like, how come you're lagging behind? And I stuttered, and I was like, he said, where were you? And I stuttered, and I said, I just threw my pills away. It just came out. I don't know why. And next thing I know, the police are there.
Sir,
I'd just gotten saved the night before, And for the first time in my life, I'm going to do the right thing, be honest, throw my pills away, and even admit to it. And I'm going back to jail for a new charge.
This time, Frank went through complete withdrawal in jail. 2 weeks later, he went before the judge and told him the whole story.
He looked at me right in the eyes and he says, "Frank, this is the first smart thing you've done your entire life." And it's like I just started receiving all this mercy from the court that I'd never received before.
Frank had violated his probation and should have gone to prison. Instead, the judge ordered him to go back to treatment.
I'd be up all night reading the Bible. We'd do our treatment during the day, and I couldn't wait to get back to the halfway house so I could get back into that New Testament. My old heroin dealer discipled me in the Lord, and we had Bible studies at his home a couple times a week, and that went on for about a year.
After 60 felony convictions, 18 years behind bars, and 30 stints in drug rehab, Frank finally changed.
Jesus was the only way that would work for me. And he set me free where nothing else could.
More than a decade later, Frank is happily married and has a successful painting business. He says he's confident in God's mercy because he's experienced it firsthand.
He knows what's best for us. It's not hopeless. He's there waiting for you to ask him. Just let him in.